The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Mullins and Kevin Larame, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night. Welcome to Soccer Today for Thursday, February 3rd, 2022. I'm Kev Larame, joined by Duane Mullins as always. And today, joining the show, President of Canada Soccer. What a day to be alive. What a beautiful day. Nick, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Duane. It is a wonderful day. I know we're all smiling. I think my ears hurt because I'm still smiling. But, you know, just imagine where we were, you know, just a year ago when we had learned that we would have to go through the depths of Concacaf just to even get to the dance. And here we are in the middle of the dance and we are the, you know, the kings of the dance. So it's a very happy day and I'm glad to share it with both of you.
Well, even go back to a little bit further when you wouldn't have even been in that final round based on the original qualifying format. Speaking of which, the live FIFA rankings, 33rd you're up to. I don't know if you knew that, but 33rd.
Yeah, 33rd. Yeah, keeping an eye on that, Duane, as you know, because, you know, when you're winners and you're top of the table, you can start talking about other things, like what pot are we going to be in? So that's the trend now I see on social media. Everybody wants to gun for pot three.
There you go. Before we get into the serious questions here, Nick, how's the statue of Atiba coming?
Unbelievable, man. Like, okay, so guys, I'm in my 50s. I still play old timers and I hurt, you know, what used to take a day to recover from now takes a week to recover from. And to know that he's turning 39 in a few days and he is still world class. It's a freak of nature. I think it was Gareth and Terry in the One Soccer feed that said, he is de facto the best professional athlete that this country has ever created. Obviously, the three of us are biased, but we got to keep our hands up to keep on cheering that.
Yeah, fair enough. Well, you mentioned here, to be somewhat serious, you mentioned it being over 50 and playing plus 50s. Oh, how does the CSA, to put your president hat on now, how does the CSA take advantage of this to increase registration in the plus 50s, to increase registration in the U8s, the U12s, the U whatever, you know, to get more people playing this game, more people supporting the game? How do you take advantage of what's happening?
So this is obviously a priority for the board, Duane. It's a great question. And, you know, it's not just age, it's also gender. You know, there's a halo effect. When the men do well, it impacts the women. When the women do well, it impacts the men. Let's be honest, being champions, that was a woman thing for the last decade, you know, so it's the ladies that paved the way, especially with that gold medal. And now the men too. So to know that we are a FIFA organization among 211 and both our men and women are kicking butt is an amazing thing, Duane. But to answer your question, COVID hit us hard, Duane, as you know, especially when it comes to youth registrations all across the country. You know, in some provinces, you know, we had, you know, we were down to maybe 25, 30, 35% of pre-pandemic levels for registration. And then, of course, the lockdowns don't help either, because even if you're registered and you want to play, the kids can't play. They're not allowed to play. So, you know, it's February 3rd in Ontario, if you're listening. You know, we just had, you know, the Ontario government soften, I guess is the right way to describe it, the lockdown scenario. Which is perfect timing for us in this province, as you know, because, you know, in a couple of months, we'll have summer registration, the weather will get better. And I'm hoping that halo effect also impacts the fact that little Johnny and little Christine want to look up to Jonathan David and Christine St. Clair and say, oh, my God, those are my heroes. Mommy and Daddy, I want to play soccer this summer.
Fair enough. Just so people understand, what exactly do you view the CSA's role in terms of supporting the international team? And what is the national team's role in terms of supporting the rest of the system? If you follow that sort of open-ended question there, how do you view the CSA's role in all that?
I mean, obviously the CSA has a mandate to support soccer as a full enterprise, right? Let's call it the whole pyramid, just for the lack of a better term. But the men's team and the women's team, they play a critical role because they're at the tip of the pyramid, right? Like everything leads up to them. So clearly our role is to make sure to support them to, you know, we act as a conduit. So, you know, if Own the Podium, for example, from the government of Canada has funding for Olympic champions, you know, that flows through us and to the women. And similarly with any prize money that might come from CONCACAF or FIFA. But as you know, Duane, you know, we've had very little activity on the youth side, for example. You know, there was a cancellation U13 Scotiabank Champions League, U15 CONCACAF, U17 CONCACAF, U20 CONCACAF. So we have a priority to get back into action on the youth side because it's very, very important. Obviously, FIFA drives a lot of that because if they cancel competitions, it's very difficult for us then to justify spending money on camps when there is no, what's the word, you know, light at the end of the tunnel, so to speak. But yeah, now, you know, I can tell you that, you know, we just approved our budget for 22 a couple of days ago at the board meeting in Hamilton. That was supposed to happen, of course, before the Hamilton game live, but COVID changed that as well. And we are now moving forward. The women have their qualifications on the youth side moving forward this summer. And then, of course, we'll slowly start up again on the male side as well. But you're absolutely right. The tip of the iceberg, of course, are the senior national teams, but they also drive support for our youth national teams that we need to reinvest in as well.
This morning, Canada wakes up with 25 points on top of the table in CONCACAF, undefeated, undisputedly top of the octagonal championship, the road to Qatar. Mathematically speaking, Qatar is closer than anywhere else on the planet. How does a Canadian soccer fan and Canada soccer president react when he woke up this morning?
So I'll tell you how I react, because Kevin, you know this about me. I'm a fan, first and foremost, way before I got involved in administration and coaching. I mean, I was a fan. I was a player. My kids play. This family is a soccer family. I come from a Greek background. I'll tell you one thing, Kevin, my Greek relatives, they don't bother me anymore. I'll tell you that much. I mean, for decades, it was all about how, what do you mean you play soccer in Canada? Don't you guys have igloos and snow there? You guys don't know what soccer is. You're a hockey player. And of course, Greece wins 2004 Euros, and I'm on the Danforth in Toronto celebrating with my relatives. And now, guess what I get to do? Talk to my relatives to say, hey, by the way, Greece, Italy, Portugal, they might not be in Qatar by the end of this year. And we have one foot in Qatar already. So it's unbelievable. I mean, I was around in 86. Obviously, I was old enough to watch that. But yeah, I mean, let's be honest. We don't have to say this on the show because I want to make sure that this is an uplifting show. There's been a lot of disappointment, you know, from then to now. So for all the people that are soccer fans, for the Voyageurs and all their supporters, you know, this is now the time to celebrate the fruits of the labor. Enjoy it, you know, not only on the men's side, but the women's side as well, because it's unprecedented. And for anybody else, Kevin and Duane, that wants to jump on the bandwagon, we welcome you. Soccer is a welcoming sport. Please jump on the bandwagon, because you have no idea what you're going to see between now and Qatar. I invited some friends of mine who absolutely know nothing about soccer to the Hamilton match on the weekend. And Kevin and Duane, let me tell you, they freaked out. Wow. These are baseball people, basketball people. They freaked out. They said they had never experienced something like that in their lives.
It is impressive. And of course, from the rise of Jonathan David to the blossoming of Tejan Buchanan, all this arriving at the same time. I'm a statistician. I love to look at probabilities. And when we think about the probabilities of everything aligning for this amazing run of Canada, six straight wins in World Cup qualifying, from playing with Alphonso Davies and him being the best player in CONCACAF to Canada missing Alphonso Davies for three games, Eustachio for two, and still going 9 points. How is it, I'm wondering how the experience is from the inside, from seeing that rise a couple years ago when you were elected president, and we saw the rise, we see the rise, it's a mantra. But now with truly the stars are aligned when we see the rise of all these players blossoming at the same time, the logistic behind getting all the players there, just as Stephen Eustachio and all the logistic, and the recent commitment of Canada Soccer to properly support that national team so that we can see the result on the field. I'm wondering, from the inside, how does it feel?
I mean, from the inside, yes, it's glorious. But I also need to tell you from the inside, Kevin, there's a lot of stuff the average person doesn't see, which, you know, is a nightmare. It keeps me up late at night. You know, we don't talk about the COVID tests that come back inconclusive, for example. And now we have only a smaller window to get a COVID test to come back negative so the player can play. You know, we don't talk about the challenges of travel, you know, the thousands of kilometers that these players, especially, just imagine coming from Turkey, for example, and making it all the way to Toronto just to start what they went through in the last week. You know, the discussion about where we should play, you know, and everybody across the country has their opinion, you know, play in Vancouver at BC Place and get 50,000 seats, or play, you know, in Montreal or Toronto. And you know, at the end of the day, it's very important for me as president to always remember one thing. It's about the players on the field, period. You know, we can get caught up in governance and rules and money and budgets and all the stuff I'm supposed to be responsible for. But at the end of the day, we got to put the conditions on the field so the players can maximize their potential. And I think that's what's happening. That's why you see the golden generation clicking. And I know, Kevin, you made a list of all the things that are happening. Don't forget John, because,
yeah,
you know, he is a very important piece of this. I don't think anybody is going to argue against you. But let's be honest, a few years ago, that wasn't necessarily a popular choice. So and I'm very happy for John, too, because I know how hard he works. And if you speak to any of the players, they will tell you how hard he works. I mean, the guy lives on the West Coast in Vancouver. I live in Hamilton. So he's already 3 hours behind me. And he gets up way before I do, already sending me emails and reports and analysis. And another thing that you guys don't hear is, you know, a lot of these players, don't forget, we borrow them from their clubs, right? So the clubs really have to trust us. The amount of trust and respect that Canada Soccer has now from those clubs is unprecedented. That's another positive thing that I wanted to mention. And John has a lot to do with that because he sends reports, analytic reports, back to the clubs after the window is done. How much did they run? What did they do? What's their health? What's their injury situation, their nutrition session? And I've had some of these sports directors from some of the best clubs in the world tell me, Nick, I have never seen such comprehensive reports come from national teams after players return. And that, again, is John.
Duane will ask the next question, but you talk about the work, and I've heard stories of John Herdman being not only the first one in, but working like days ahead. For some reason, he has a time machine and he's able to go back in time and work harder, and he gets the trust that way. And it's fun to see his tactical evolution. Also, because when we look at how he surrounds himself too, Mauro Biello, and how he has grown from the Excel program to all the way to his right-hand man. But when I'm looking at tactically the evolution of Canada, I've never seen Canada adjust tactically to today's game. Forward thinking, even when we look at the midfield, how Tajon Buchanan is used, and how he's breaking rules. He's breaking rules of soccer, putting players from the right to the left mid-games and redoing again. But it seems to be working.
It does.
So go ahead.
You're right. That is a maturation process that a coach will go through. I've noticed it too as a fan. Obviously, I'm not involved with the technical staff. That's John's responsibility. But I've noticed it as a fan too. I mean, when he makes a change and just the immediate impact that reconfiguration. A perfect example was last night, Kevin. You know, we had that change. Not sure exactly what minute it was in. Maybe Duane will remember, but three players came in. You know who the three players were. And boom, like right away, the game changed. And I mean, up to that point, you could argue that El Salvador was giving us problems and it, you know, that we might not break the deadlock. So I think that's what you're speaking about, Kevin, is this idea that he surrounds himself by people that he trusts. And more importantly, he does the work. I mean, I can tell you that the game plan is a detailed analysis of every potential algorithm, every potential permutation and combination. In the 60th minute, if this is happening in the game, then this is the type of change we're going to make. You know, that type of complexity, which you can see the fruits of the labor today.
Yeah, I think it was about the 70th minute, because I remember El Salvador was kind of not dominating, but had the better
play for the
first 20 there. I want to turn the attention away from the man. I know that's blasphemy on today, but we do forget, I think, somehow that the Olympic champions are also from this country.
That's right.
The women, and unfortunately because of COVID, and I wasn't inside to know this, but I assume that the own fact there was only two celebration games is likely largely to do with the fact that it would have been very difficult to get that off in such difficult circumstances. But is there plans to get that team in front of more Canadians as soon as possible?
Yeah, Duane, and you're right. I mean, it became difficult towards the end, as you know, and in speaking to the players as well. I mean, the last thing they want to do is also have a celebration tour, and when only a few thousand people are allowed to be there celebrating with them. So it's not an optimal solution. And, you know, after Ottawa and Montreal, as you know, the weather started getting a little bad in certain parts of Canada. So that also is a problem. But And I've said this to Bev and to the women. I go, we don't have to have a celebration tour immediately after the Olympics. Why? You are Olympic champions. No one's going to take that away from you. And if we can resurrect a couple more games, let's do that, you know, in the spring when things turn around, the weather's better. And obviously all of us want to keep our fingers crossed that we're coming to the end of whatever we're calling this version of COVID. But unfortunately, Duane, how many times in the last 2 years have all three of us probably said, yeah, I think we're coming towards the end. And then we end up finding out, no, it's just the beginning of something new. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed. But to answer your question, yes, obviously, we're hoping to resurrect the celebration tour.
All right. More of a comment before my final question. What I do want, Nick, is to be able to buy those gold trimmed Canadian jerseys at some point. So
I know they're awesome. Yeah, they are awesome.
Yeah, fair enough. Speaking of future events, though, 2026 is, you know, in the future, but it is important to start planning for that. We have, of course, the two host visits, which have reported to have gone well. Sure. We should hear back soon on that, I think, probably in the spring. We'll hear whether they're confirmed there. How do you approach this? Planning already underway, I'm sure John is, but on the CSA level, at a board level, to try and maximize the preparation time for the team heading into the 26th World Cup?
Awesome question, Duane. Let me speak to that. So yeah, you're right. The FIFA inspection team came in November. They started it in Toronto and then they went to Edmonton. I was there for both inspection tours. They went really, really well. So, I mean, off the record, I spoke to the investigators. You're trying to get some insight as to how do you feel? How was this compared to the Americans? You know, so both presentations were world-class. So I'm very, very pleased from that perspective. Now, make no mistake, Duane, there's things we need to fix, right? Obviously, BMO's got to get a little bit bigger. You know, Commonwealth's going to have to get some grass. There's a lot of things that we need to fix, but they're not insurmountable is what I'm trying to say. And my latest communication with the FIFA office is that we're expecting to hear towards the end of the first quarter, the beginning of the second quarter. So in simple English, that probably means late March, early April, which is in and around the FIFA Congress and the draw for the World Cup. So I think that's when they're going to probably make those final decisions. I'm confident as president, I'm supposed to be confident that Toronto and Edmonton are in. Now, what are we doing moving forward? Well, this is part and parcel of our strat plan, our brand new strat plan for 22 to 26. And part of the strat plan started with Peter Montopoli. So Peter Montopoli, who now moves from General Secretary of Canada Soccer over to heading up the local organizing committee for 2026. That's a huge benefit to us. Just like my friend Victor Montagliani moving from president of Canada Soccer to president of CONCACAF and FIFA vice president. At the end of the day, a lot of these things, these actions, these strategies, these decisions, it's about people. And for the longest time, Duane, you know, Canada Soccer wasn't, you know, considered a place to get expertise, let's be honest. And you know, if you go back 50, 60, 70 years, how many times did we ever have anybody at FIFA? How many times did we ever have anybody at CONCACAF? And now we're filling those positions with respected Canadians and learning how that network and those behaviors happen at that level, at the CONCACAF level. I was just elected to CONCACAF Council, and I am now learning how to impose myself at that level as well. So it's part and parcel of our strategy. As you know, Duane, we have a executive search process right now for a brand new general secretary to replace, Peter Montopoli. And that is one of his number one priorities, is making sure that we leverage FIFA 26 in terms of facilities. One last thing I'm going to say, Duane, everybody talks about Toronto and Edmonton, and fine, that's very, very important. But I also want to talk about hosting cities. That's a huge topic of conversation. For example, I'll just use Hamilton as an example. Hamilton could be a hosting city. A hosting city sometimes gets even more benefits than hosting a game. The game is 90 minutes, but when you're a hosting city and you get Italy or Serbia or Croatia or Greece actually training at Tim Hortons Field every day for 30 days, living there, going to restaurants, networking, socializing with fans who get to watch them train, that's a huge opportunity for a lot of other cities across Canada.
When we look at the journey, not only to 2026, when the World Cup will be in our backyard, but the journey to Qatar, how is the correlation between the two? How does a likelihood of qualifying for Qatar benefit the players going into also 2026, but also the federation, because logistically speaking, having experience and people in place, it probably helps the preparation for the upcoming World Cup.
Yeah, I think logistically it's a big one, Kevin, because, you know, one of the minor, but it's a subtle difference, but it's a very important one to mention from a technical perspective. The World Cup is tournament football. Tournament football is entirely different than, you know, a window of three games. You know, not to disrespect a window of three games, but you understand the difference, right? And guess what? John has done pretty good in tournament football. That's the good news. So we don't have a coach walking into this having never experienced what it's going to be like to actually bring a team together over a 3-4 week period to maximize performance. That's the first thing. The second thing, of course, are the players. The players, it's always an evolution, right? The roster today did not look like the roster 2-3 years ago and will not look like the roster 2 or 3 years from now. So what we have to make sure is that there's always a cohort of individuals that maintains that continuity from one so-called generation to the next. You know, we're even debating what the roster is going to be like in November versus what it was last night. I mean, there's going to be changes just in that short term period as well. So it's roster, it's coaching. And then with regards to logistics, that's a huge one, Kevin, because, you know, you have staff who work their butts off. So let me give a shout out to the staff, because they're often forgotten when it comes to the media and newspapers and, you know, giving the glory to players and John. These people, they work their butts off. They're behind the scenes. They do everything in their power to get the team ready. So this journey that we're going on with one step in Qatar, it's just as much a celebration of our staff. So I wanted to make sure I put that out there. But they also need to garner experience on the World Cup stage, because that will only assist us, you know, 4 years later in 2026. So the benefits, Kevin, are on all multiple levels.
Now, last thing before we let you go, with. Thank you for your time once again. We know you're very busy, especially on a day like today, which means what's next for the Canadian national team, the men's national team? We know that in March is the next window. We have Costa Rica, so traveling to Costa Rica on March 24th, against Jamaica, somewhere in Canada on March 27th, and against Panama on March 30th. First of all, where will the champagne be sent? Will it be sent to Costa Rica, or will it just be sent somewhere in Canada?
So here's the thing. I don't care when we clinch, because when the team comes home for the middle game, guess what? We're going to celebrate either way. We know that. Whether we clinch the first game mathematically, the second game mathematically, I don't care. The celebration that I anticipate will be gargantuan all across the country. If you think people have jumped on the bandwagon already, just wait for another 2 months of buzz before they jump on the bandwagon. The game itself and the location, I know it's another hot topic, and all I can say is let's wait for John to get home, which he's coming home today. And I can guarantee you, first thing tomorrow morning at 5 a.m. Eastern, he's probably going to message me and say, hey, Nick, I'm starting the analysis of where I think the Jamaica game should be. And he'll do the same thing that he did for Hamilton. He'll look at travel, he'll look at kilometers, he'll look at competition. But the number one factor, Kevin, is the health, welfare, and safety of the players, right? In terms of what he thinks or perceives the roster will be. And then we got Nations League, obviously coming up over the next few months, which is going to be exciting. And then, of course, we have exhibition friendlies. Pre-World Cup exhibition friendlies. Say those words, Duane, for the first time in your life. Pre-World Cup exhibition friendlies, because you know what that means? We could potentially be playing some big, big names that I know all the fans are yearning for. It's not that we're tired of CONCACAF competition, but, you know, wouldn't it be nice to play in England? Wouldn't it be nice to play in Argentina? So that's what we have to look forward to.
I really, really want you to play England eventually. I've never seen it in my lifetime in the Mets. But on my wall, I have the England-Canada pass that I did for the women's side, and that was wonderful to see that, my two heritages. But yeah, the men's side would be a great game to see, Nick.
Nick, we thank you very much for your time today. We're going to look forward to the news and, of course, say hi to all the team for us and congratulate them for their great work. And we're happy also to hear a little bit behind the scene and the way you described how important John Herdman's contribution, but the analysis and the work and about the players, that means a whole lot for people like myself, which I'm stats and data driven, which means players first. That's what it's all about. And I love to hear that. And thank you for all your work for Canada Soccer.
Well, thank you, Kevin and Duane. And you guys know that I was a fan of your show way before I was put in this position. Continue to do the great work, because I know as the MNT soars, so will your show. So best of luck in the future.
Thank you very much. And you're right, the ratings are saying so. So thank you so much, Nick. And it's a pleasure to talk to you for this show. We'll talk to you soon. We'll be right back after this short break. Duane and I will break down this victory of Canada 2-0 against El Salvador after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sports podcasting network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kev Larme joined by Duane Rollins. We're going to break down the national team result in just a second. Duane, I want to come back, talk about the interview for a second. I'm really pleased to hear from Nick Bontis, Dr. Nick Bontis, president of Canada Soccer, how, because the hot topic, we're going to talk about the game yesterday, the 25 points, six games in a row, the wins, the perfect window. We're going to break it down. But the fact that there's an analysis, which kilometers, health of the players, simulations, data-driven, where is it the best? Like, there's a model. There's a computer model that John Herman is going to run that tells him where the game should be. The fact that that's how they determine it makes me happy.
It will make anyone happy that if you believe and buy into the idea that the players have to be put first when it comes to World Cup qualifying. No, I do think the CSA should be more cognizant moving forward after that of getting, Nick mentioned those glamour friendlies. And I think probably BC Place would be a great place to bring a Brazil in, or to bring an England in, or to bring we played the U.S. a few times already. I think we could be done with them for a while. I don't know if they're glamour anymore.
It's fine,
either.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm good. Yeah. I'm good. You know, we played. Yeah. Even if I don't see Mexico for a few years, I'm kind of good too. Concacaf can be in the rear view mirror for all that's worth.
Yeah, and the Nations League games as well. I think there should be an effort to play them outside of the central part of this country. But I think when we're talking about World Cup qualifying and the Jamaica game, most of those models are going to point to
somewhere around the Pearson Airport is probably what makes sense, which is great. But thank you, Nick Bontis, for joining us today. It was a pleasure. And Nick's been a fan of the show for a while. Like you mentioned, for years, I've been seeing his name pop up. And it's great to see someone that is in a position to take decision, but also in a position to listen to all a president does. But that's not just a fan of the game, but that's been a lifelong member of this community too. So it is a fun time to be a national team follower from the men's side, the women's side. It is an amazing time right now. One thing is that when we look at the games like yesterday and the squad decision by John Herdman and the result on the game and then his substitutions and then the... So if Maradona's goal, well, the hand of God, what is it? The butt, the butt goal, or the forehead of God too, I guess, for Atiba Hutchinson. But that was amazing. Like, come on, Canada beat El Salvador in San Salvador in Estadio Cuscatlan. Yeah, that's quite something, Duane.
Yeah. I tweeted out last night. I had to make it a little about myself because tweeted out it was the first time that they'd won in El Salvador since the Dallas Cowboys were world champions, or Super Bowl champions anyway. It depends how you feel with the CFL's matchup in that. But nonetheless, it's been a long, long time, and that illustrates just how long it is, because, you know, they're making memes about that now that doesn't happen anymore. So, look, it was a big win, and it was a bigger win than I think we gave it credit for because of that very reason. It's been a long time since Canada won anywhere in Central America, let alone do it twice in one window, let alone to go, what, into 17 games undefeated in World Cup qualifying. 17 games undefeated in World Cup qualifying. I'm not sure.
Six straight wins. Wayne, that's six times three. That's 18. It's 18 points in a row. That's insane. Yeah. They didn't just go to El Salvador to defend either. To just got him on the counter. They got 51% of the ball, 15 shots, 5 on target. That's one third of their shot were on target. That's high club level here. 78% pass accuracy for Canada. That's almost unprecedented. 11 corners. You know how I like that stat, because it's more than just corners. It indicates pressure put on the team. And then you have that moment where Johnston, Tejan Buchanan, and another player that escapes my thought right now came into the 70th minute and changed the game and created everything. It's quite frankly a professional performance by Canada. They did not even play their best game, and they were able to get a 2-0 win on the road like this when you don't even play your best game. A 4-3-3 to start the game for Canada. Osorio as the left attacking midfielder with David and Hoylett. The decisions of Miller. Eustaquio was ready to go, like we alluded to yesterday. Danilo Henry got his yellow card, which means he'll be missing the next game. Same for Adekube. But this professional performance by Canada is what is impressing me, Duane. The fact that they've played not their best game and they've won 2-0 in El Salvador.
Yeah, the third player that you're forgetting was that, you know, fringe squad player, Tejan Buchanan.
Oh, yeah. So Buchanan came on. Then you had also, who else came on to 70th minute?
Well, Johnson and Lauren there. And
Lauren is the one I was forgetting.
Osorio came off a little bit after that, too, because he had gone pretty hard in the game before. They sort of rotated the MLS guys. I think John Herbin deserves a lot of credit for how he handled the MLS guys in this window. Marc-Anthony Kay sat out the entirety of the first game to allow him to play some really significant minutes in Hamilton and to end the game out there. You know, he rotates in. Rotating players for 5-10 minutes here. He deserves a lot of credit for how he handled the minutes, for sure. Look, when you're talking about that game, you're right. There was a stretch of maybe 20 minutes at the end of the first half, 20 minutes at the start of the second half, where I would say that it was your eye test told you that El Salvador was kind of taking a bit of control, and it changed with that sub. Now, I think Kyle Larm was the key player in that. His presence up top forced El Salvador to get away from their pressing a little bit. They had to be aware of his ability to hit them. It opened up more space for John David, who obviously, you know, paid dividends at the end with his second breakaway and the goal of the two games in a row where he gets a pure breakaway goal.
And his second chip goal, like his second goal of the year worthy candidate in the same freaking window.
Yeah, but as much as I want to take a step back too, I think the other part of this, you're right, they didn't defend for 90 minutes, for sure. El Salvador is not that type of team that would require that, but they did defend when they had to. And even though there was that 40-minute stretch, I would suggest that they were never really in peril in that. Milos Borjan didn't make a save until stoppage time second half.
But what a save was it? It was, but you're right. It's the 93rd minute.
Two saves that were pretty decent in stoppage time. So that's a...
Can you imagine our reaction if that ball goes in? Dwayne, you and I lose our shit if that ball goes in. Sorry for my language. If that ball goes in, we're like, well, here we go again. It all starts again. This was all for nothing. Canada's going to do the bad to you know what, and we're all going to be disappointed. If that ball goes in from midpoint of the field, that's exactly how we think. Like Ben Rycroft takes a glass and shoves it against the wall type of moment.
Yeah, at the Duke of Gloucester, downtown Toronto.
May you rest in peace, Duke of Gloucester.
Yeah, alas, oh my God, what a place. It's still probably, they're probably still detoxing the place. But anyway, moving on from that. That save too, if you want to look at that in isolation and then look at how the rest of the evening played out, that would have been the difference between Canada being sitting here today knowing that they're guaranteed fourth place at the minimum. And that's buried the friggin' league guide.
Yeah.
Canada
will at least play a game. Exactly. Canada literally will be going to Qatar because that game will take place in Qatar. So worst case scenario, Canada plays one game against New Zealand to go to Qatar. Well, just to go into the World Cup, basically. And the way Canada's playing, do you fancy yourself against New Zealand? So, you know, that's where mathematics come into play.
Yeah. To be real quick on that, I ran a few scenarios last night, and I'm not 100% sure on this because I need like a model to do it. But I do believe that Canada would clinch. There's several scenarios in which they clinch, several results which will clinch it for them outside of their own even. And one of them includes, as far as I can tell,
Panama losing.
If there is a result, a win
in the U.S.-Mexico game. They both of those teams need to take a draw for them both to pass Canada. So that's tells you something right there. So all you need to do is cheer for one of them to win, and it's in Azteca. So there you go.
We saw the statistics of the game. We've talked about it for a sec. You've talked about the standings. Let's take a look at it. And there's two red X's. Honduras and Jamaica are done. They're done. They're well cooked. And they will not be going to Qatar in any capacity outside of as fans. So,
And El Salvador can't drop a single more point.
Exactly. El Salvador is like hanging on by one finger.
For four.
For four. Be like, we're here. We're still here. We're truly not, but we're still holding on. Canada 25 points, United States 21, Mexico 21, Panama 17. We'll break down the results of those games in 1 minute or so. Costa Rica is fifth, but with 16 points. A big result, big window for them this time around. They're in conversation, and now it's truly a pick'em between Panama and Costa Rica for that half spot against Oceania's representative in Qatar. And again, El Salvador is just there for the form. There's 7 points between Costa Rica and El Salvador. Costa Rica basically salvaged their World Cup qualifying round with this window's performance, and we'll break that down in a second. We've talked about Canada with Nick. We've talked about it. We've talked about John Herdman's decision in this one. What is most surprising to you? That Canada wins and is assured of a fourth place, and then we're moving on, or the fact that we forget Alfonso Davies was not even playing these three games and there's three wins on the board?
Well, I mean, I think we've kind of dealt with that. That emotionally, we dealt with it when it was announced, and I think we've intellectually dealt with it after the first two games of this window where they already had 6 points. It was already going to be a successful window without him, regardless of the result last night. I mean, that was literally the cherry on top of your sundae last evening to get the win down in El Salvador to pretty much do the clip. But yeah, this is at the point too, and another good part of this is you now have so much leeway that you don't need to rush Alfonso Davies back. You can be much more safe. You don't have to necessarily take a risk that's unnecessary with him, with his health and with his fitness, and allow
November,
him to stay back.
How's November feeling for you? I'm good. Yeah. If he comes back, you know, there's a good song from my youth, from Wyclef Jean, and I think it may be a good time for Alfonso Davies to tell his friends and his loved ones that in the national team setting that he'll be gone till November.
Yeah, I mean, maybe you bring him in for the Nations League or something to test him out, but you also want to make sure that you best maximize it. And if they do play a glamour friendly, I'm sure that he'll want to be involved in that. But nonetheless, it's remarkable. And it's remarkable that you could do it with Stefan Eustachio missing, Porto's Stefan Eustachio now, right? Like, you don't even have to, like, sort of explain who he is anymore very, very often. In the neighborhood I live in, you certainly don't. The neighbors above that I talk about sometimes on Twitter, the ones that are very loud and passionate, they are Porto fans. So they know who Stefan Eustachio is now.
They do now, and that's the beautiful thing here. So we are going to move on. Let's break down the other results in CONCACAF, because there was three other games last night. Some teams were eliminated, like Jamaica. So let's take a look at the Reggae Boys result from yesterday. 1-0 victory for Costa Rica at Independence Stadium in Kingston, Jamaica. Former MLS player Joel Campbell, who famously played for the Earthquakes, if I'm not mistaken. That's early 2010, so I'm testing my memory limits here at this point. Scored a winning goal at the 62nd minute. Jamaica is mathematically eliminated from World Cup contention. Even when they got 15 shots, 4 on target, they got more of the ball. Pretty high pass accuracy, 88% pass accuracy over 606 passes. But unfortunately, it wasn't enough. Counter-attack, Costa Rica got the result they needed. And Costa Rica, like we've talked about now, are in the conversation to join Panama. There's only a point difference between the two. That's the biggest battle in this octagonal road to Qatar, is Panama and Costa Rica.
Yeah, and Canada will have a big role to play in determining who gets through with that, or perhaps making it difficult for both of them in the next window. I did watch the entirety of the Jamaica-Costa Rica game. That was my other focus last night. And, you know, I felt for the Jamaicans a little bit. They deserved much more on the night. And I'd say the same thing about Panama earlier in the window, but perhaps that's stylistically or tactical by Costa Rica. I'm not 100% sure if it's not luck, though. But nonetheless, they did get the result they needed. Jamaica basically lost its campaign in the early part of it when they weren't able to get the full you know, the very first window, if you go back to way back when, the very first window, they weren't able to get very basically any of their players over from England, and that really put them on the back foot in this qualifying campaign right away, and they were never able to recover even when they got their players over. And now I suspect that they won't even bother trying to bring them back for the March window, which, you know, is good news for that celebration game wherever it happens here in Canada.
Exactly. We're not going to see Antonio. We're not going to see those players for Jamaica. So, and you're right, we might be onto something here. What did they allude to on the broadcast yesterday too, that the fact that Jamaica is mathematically eliminated does give Canada that even bigger leeway for their game in March.
Absolutely. And look, the Costa Rica game, as I said, both games that they won this window, they won despite the fact that they were on the back foot for most of it. They were defending not in the way that Canada was defending against the U.S. They were defending in a way of more like of a team that was getting outplayed was defending. And then they happened to get a goal. So we'll see whether they are able to catch up. But right now, I would, based on what I have seen, would very much have my money placed on Panama to grab that fourth spot, and deservedly so. They have been the fourth best team, or perhaps even the third best teams at times in this campaign.
No, I agree with you, and it's hard to view it in another way, because Panama has got those points before this window, which Costa Rica went two wins and a draw. They had 9 points. Panama had a difficult window. We've talked about the COVID cases last week, and that does explain the meager result they did have during this window compared to their prior amount of points they had. But Costa Rica took advantage of it, which was their job, and they did, and now they're part of the conversation. And Canada, like you mentioned, they'll play Costa Rica on March 24th, and on the 30th, they'll play Panama. So Canada might eliminate one, or see how this goes. The United States played yesterday too in frigid conditions. Duane, can you imagine that two players were treated for hypothermia, giving an IV, and those two players were Bubba Lopez and Romel Kyoto for Honduras. So CF Montreal fans, sorry to tell you that hypothermia was diagnosed for Romel Kyoto during the game yesterday. Minus 19 degrees Celsius was the lowest temperature recorded during the game, the coldest soccer game ever recorded in the in U.S. soccer's history. 3-win victory for the U.S. Honduras shouldn't just send the 3 points, because they got 27% of the ball, Duane. They had 59% pass accuracy, 184 passes. They were literally frozen in place during this game.
Yeah, we didn't talk about the potential El Salvador work stoppage.
That's true. During the day, El Salvador threatened to strike during the game and not play the game against Canada because of unpaid wages, bonuses, and promised way of being treated that were not come to fruition.
Yeah, the point I was making with that is I think, you know, Honduras didn't put the press release out, but they decided to basically not play as well, and I suspect that they won't for the rest of the window either.
Yeah, that's true. They're the last, you know,
if I'm the Honduran Federation, I'm bringing in an entirely, like, under 20 team basically to play those last three games, because at least you'll get an effort if you do that. And, you know, and they can figure stuff out moving forward from there. Look, the Honduras has had a nice run. They go to two World Cups in a row. They get to the playoff for the last World Cup and almost get there, even though they're at the very tail end of that cycle. And then, you know, this cycle's end. When you're a small country, and this will happen up here, you know, probably hopefully not for 8 or 10 years.
That's
but
true.
There will come a point if they don't do the work to make sure it doesn't happen, and you know, you keep golden generations end. But
Costa Rica is the next one to happen, by the way. Costa Rica is the next window to close, which might be this window. So
they're right on that cusp. They might not make the playoff, and you know, we expected Panama to be worse than they are, but they, you know, to their credit, have stepped it up. So we'll see. But yeah, the U.S. game, look, two players treated for hypothermia, that might suggest to me they weren't running enough, but...
Well, the stats of the passing accuracy and the passes would tell me the same thing, too. I'm wondering, it's too bad I don't have access to the kilometers run, because I would have loved to see that stuff. Well, the funny thing is the more you run, the less cold you are. So I'm wondering why. So, but apparently it was very difficult. And we have to think about the goalkeepers because it's really difficult for them. But also, like, if I was going to play in these conditions, the rules don't say that you don't, you're not allowed to play with a jacket on. There's no rule that says you're not allowed to play with, like, ski pants. And, like, you're allowed. You're actually allowed. Dude, I would come out there with my ski-doo suit, and I'd be ready to go.
Yeah, to be serious, for sure, as much as clothing as you can get on, play, like, four layers of jersey, for sure. As anyone who knows, as a Canadian, we all know this. It's not about the thickness of your jacket. It's about how many layers you're wearing. If you're from the South and you're coming to a Northern game, don't bring a big jacket. Bring seven sweaters. That's how you stay warm. But at any rate, to be serious for a second, I suspect that some lessons have been learned by this game because I don't think you should have players treated for hypothermia. Now, that said,
no. You shouldn't risk to lose a toe when you're playing soccer.
Yeah. The counter argument to that is that you shouldn't also be playing games at high noon in Central America.
Exactly.
But they kind
exactly.
of don't allow that anymore, too. So,
true.
Yeah. That's make sure that we don't put players in that situation again because it's not really fair. Now, up here, it's a bit different because we're northern country. So if you're going to have home games and you have to have home games.
Don't have a choice.
Yeah, like maybe you could not schedule the January window up here, but that would mean we'd have a three home game window somewhere else in the cycle. So whatever, we won't have three game windows again. So that might not happen for a very long time. And it was a spectacle of sorts. I think the Edmonton game, if you're going to rank the three ice games in the CONCACAF window. Yeah. I think it's clearly Ice Teca followed by, I guess, four games because there's a Costa Rica game there too. So I would say it's Ice Teca followed by Hamilton, followed by the Costa Rica game, followed by the fourth place was the Minnesota game.
Yeah,
that was just cold. It wasn't like pretty.
So what should be the nickname?
It was just cold.
So what was the nickname of that game then? So we have the Ice Teca, we have the Ice Gab, which, by the way, it's a terrible name.
That's just marketing tie-in.
I know, like, you're not even paid and you came up with that. Well, were you? I don't know. We came up with that nickname. Anyways, good on you, Wheels. But that's also what could be fun is what would be the name? The Frozen Pond game, Minnesota Pond, the Twin Cities, or the Twin Glacier, or I don't know.
Yeah. We'll let we have Minnesota listeners.
The Twin Frozen Loons.
Yeah, we'll let Brian or someone that we've had from Minnesota, Jeff. So we've had a few Minnesota guests over the year. We'll let them come up with it. I'm not sure. But no, look, the U.S. was the better team, though, in the night to make it about the football. And there was never any doubt that the U.S. is going to qualify for this World Cup. It's never any doubt that the top three teams are. It's been pretty clear there's been a separation there with Panama, the only kind of interesting subplot in this entire thing. Costa Rica has made it interesting for that fourth place spot. I think either of those teams versus New Zealand will be a fair, even contest. I might give even New Zealand a bit of edge in that because they will be immediately coming out of their qualifying, albeit it's like we shouldn't assume it's New Zealand, I suppose. But I mean, come on.
Well, exactly. Like
they will have some warm-up games immediately before in Qatar, so they'll be used to the conditions a little bit more. So it'll depend on whoever gets that fourth place spot. It'll be important for them to get over there earlier. It's going to be an expensive undertaking for whatever federation has to do it, because they're going to want to make sure that they don't go into that game, you know, playing in the desert with a team that's been used to it at that point. Even if they are just playing the Solomon Islands, they're still going to be used to playing. So I would give a little bit of a nod to New Zealand in that regard. So you're going to have to prepare for that.
Yeah, sounds like a good plan. Playing in the desert sounds like a rock song.
Just like the Men at Work did it or something,
All right, last game to break down from last night, Mexico-Panama. 1-0 victory for Mexico, but it came a bit harder than expected. The victory came from the penalty spot. Raul Jimenez, at the 80th minute, got the 3 points for L3 with their terrible new logo on the penalty, which nothing quite convincing. 14 shots, 2 on target, 55% possession, 355 passes, which is very low for a Mexican team that used to tout themselves as a ball-controlling team. 76% pass accuracy. Those numbers are just numbers. I mean, they're nothing quite spectacular, which is my narrative here. Mexico ain't nothing special. Mexico is where they should be in that table.
Yeah, no, I think we've said that throughout. I think both Mexico and the U.S. suffer kind of from the same sort of area too, as I wouldn't necessarily think that their final ball is necessarily as good as it's been in the past at times. Mexico has just not looked as good, and that goes all the way into the Gold Cup as well. The Gold Cup where they were lucky to make a final, really. I mean, that was, to me, when I go back, if I want to make this about Canada again, because why not? We had the Canadian CSA president on here, and we are a Canadian show.
Yeah.
That semifinal, U.S. or Mexico-Canada, in the summer really should have been more of a preview of what we were seeing. Mexico was lucky to win that game. Canada was very good in that game and probably very unlucky to allow that late goal, which, you know, only happened so late because the Mexican fans decided to chant to get the game even more stoppage time, and a gassed Canadian team wasn't able to hold on for a little bit longer. But nonetheless, not to make excuses about the summer, I think it did give us a preview on that, and it gave us a preview on both sides of that, because Mexico has not been anywhere close to the capital M, oh my God, we're playing Mexico of the past. Panama gave them everything they could yesterday, because Panama's good and they're playing hard and they're playing, you know, motivated and focused towards getting that four spot, because they've, I think, approached this window realizing that that was their best chance in. And then I think they, just like we, look at New Zealand as a very winnable game and want to get there to do that. And once you're in Qatar, it's going to suck for whoever. Can you imagine? You go to Qatar and you have that one game, and you're like, you'll see the branding. Like, you'll be able to see the branding there.
You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of when I used to be a young adult and trying to go to clubs, and you just, like, you go to the club, you wait in line to get in, and you get to the bouncer, you get to the doorman or the woman or door person, and they look at you, they look how you're dressed, they ask you, are you with anybody? You're like, no. Is your name on the list? You're like, no. Well, you're not coming in. That's literally how those teams will feel.
Yeah, it'll feel pretty terrible. Or it reminds me, you know, to give us a bit of a nod to our show that'll be starting tomorrow after the opening ceremonies, the Five Rings podcast. It's like when they the Alpine ski team used to be so strong that they would bring like seven downhillers to the Olympics, and then they'd all play in the training before the Olympics start, and only three would get to go actually race in the Olympics. So it's similar to that.
Yeah, and it was always Ermin Meyer winning anyway. So the Herminator would come down the strife.
Yes, and if you get more insight like that, you can listen to the Five Rings podcast daily.
Also, later today, college basketball on Betting on Sports podcast. It's been going really well on the college basketball front over the last few days. But thank you to Nick Bontis for joining us today, president of the Canadian Soccer Association. He joined us for over 25 minutes of great content. If you're just joining us, you can go back to the beginning of the show and listen to us. Thank you for listening to us on podcast, YouTube. It's always a pleasure. You can follow Duane on social media at 24th Minute, myself at Kev Larame, and this show at Soccer Today SPN. We'll be back tomorrow with a brand new edition of the World of Football with a soccer perspective. The international break is over. Major League Soccer is 23 days away. And we're going to start to break it down soon and more on Soccer Today. But as always, until next time, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.